Hi guys, welcome to the webinar. A little bit of information on coastal impact. We were established in 2009 and our charter is essentially marine education, conservation and research. I also own Barracuda Diving, which was established in Goa in 1993. So I think it's probably the oldest recreational scuba diving center on mainland India anyway. We are running a micro fragmentation project right now. So of course, because of the monsoons, we have stopped at the moment, but we will be restarting in October. An environmental eDNA project is on the cards. We are waiting for funding. And also we are running these educational webinars. Plus also we are doing a slideshow presentation in schools, online of course, right now, to let people become more aware about marine conservation and awareness. So that is what we do. Yeah. So who's Elrica? So Elrica has been studying dugongs since the year 2007, I believe. That's wonderful. I don't think I'd even heard of dugongs at that time. She's a research associate with Nature Conservation Foundation. And she's studying seagrass ecosystems in the Andaman and Nicobar, as well as the Lakshadweep archipelagos. Research mainly focuses on the interaction between seagrasses and large herbivores such as dugongs and sea turtles in these ecosystems. Okay, so she shuttles between Bangalore, Goa, Andamans, Lakshadweep, and wherever you find dugongs, right? And seagrass, of course. So I'm going to now hand over to Elrica.
So good evening, everyone. My name is Elrica and I work with an organization called Nature Conservation Foundation. My research is actually in the field of marine biology, and over the last 15 years, I have actually focused on understanding the relationships between dugongs and seagrasses in the Andaman and Nicobar archipelago. Presently, I'm also involved in understanding these similar relationships in the Lakshadweep islands, and here the focus is primarily on the green sea turtles. So today I will be speaking about dugongs of the Indian waters, and more specifically those from the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, because that's where we presently have most of our information from, and it's also where I've done most of my research. So I will start off by telling you a bit about seagrasses, because this is something that's lesser known. So seagrasses are flowering plants that actually grow in shallow waters in the sea where sunlight reaches, because they require sunlight to prepare their food. So almost like how plants on land require sunlight, these also require sunlight, and hence you'll find them in shallow waters. And they may be like these tiny leaves that you can see on the screen. So they may be as small as less than 1 centimeter, or thin blades like these, which are a few mm wide. And they can also grow to several meters long, such as the one you are seeing here. And as they grow, they spread out and they actually form these extensive meadows. So what you're seeing here is actually the aerial view of a meadow in Little Andaman Islands in the Andaman Archipelago. It actually stretches out to several kilometers. And in fact, there are some areas across the world that they don't know how vast these meadows can actually go to. So the meadow is actually this whole area where seagrasses colonize and are found. So now these meadows, these seagrass meadows, actually play a very important role in the coastal ecosystem. Some of these roles actually involve them holding onto the sediment with their roots and kind of stabilizing the sediments in the area. So as a result, it prevents erosion, and to some extent, even the beach wherever seagrass meadows are present are also kind of stable. So we found that in areas where, you know, seagrass meadows have actually eroded, the beach also erodes. Then another function of seagrass is actually to trap these sediments. So with their blades, they actually kind of, break the water flow and prevent the resuspension of sediments. So as a result, the clarity of the water increases. And they also are a home to a lot of sea creatures, some small fish, lots of mollusks. And in fact, they're also a nursery ground for juvenile fish. And some of the larger animals that are really dependent on seagrasses are the green sea turtles, which are dependent on it for food, and the dugongs, which almost exclusively depend on seagrasses as a source of food. Now, to tell you a bit about dugong, I'll just play a video. The dugong is actually a large marine mammal, and it has the face of a pig and the body of a dolphin, if that's what it looks like to most of you. And this is a video that was actually shot by Vardhan in Nanaman. This was shot way back in 2007. So dugongs are herbivores, or they are vegetarians, and they feed exclusively on seagrass. And their closest relatives are actually manatees. So manatees look more or less similar to dugongs, but they have a rounded tail, and they are much larger and bigger in size. And they also go to fresh waters, whereas dugongs are only found in marine systems. And on land, the closest relative of the dugong is the elephant. In fact, some of the adult dugongs also have these tusks like elephants. And dugongs can grow to up to 6 feet in length, and they can weigh close to about 450 kgs. And they move in herds. They mostly move in herds. So in this map, you can see that dugongs are present all the way from the east coast of Africa, right up to Asia, Southeast Asia, and Australia. And the manatees are actually found on the other end, more west, from the west coast of Africa, more towards Florida and the coast there. And in India, dugongs are actually found in the Gulf of Kutch, close to Gujarat, in the Gulf of Mannar and Park Strait along the Tamil Nadu coast, and in the Andaman and Nicobar archipelago. So apparently there was a time when dugongs were also found in Ladakh about more than 100 years back, and then they were just hunted down to local extinction. I think there are also reports saying that dugong was also found more west, southwest on our west coast, and those also, I think, their numbers, but they're also no longer present in this area. So how does one study dugongs then? So if in places like Australia, which actually has one of the largest dugong populations, and in the Arabian Gulf, you see them in these large herds. And in when you go out in a boat, you can see lots of these animals. And they use a lot of aerial surveys there, where they use cameras or drones, or they use these low-flying aircrafts to actually study the animals. But in a place like most of my study refers to the Andaman research, because that's where we've done most of our research. So over there, the waters are really turbid, and the numbers of dugongs are so low that it's not very easy to see these herds of dugong. And hence, what we do is we look for these feeding signs of dugongs. So these are I'll show you to after this photo. So these cleared portions that you can see, I don't know how clear it is to everyone, but they are actually the kind of signs that dugongs leave behind after feeding. So they kind of pick on the grass and then clear out these trails. And these are signs that we look for while studying dugongs, because we know that when we see these signs, a dugong has fed in that area, at least in the last 1 week. Besides this, so those are how we know whether an animal is in the area. Then if we want to identify whether it's a male or a female, you have to actually sight the animal underwater and look at these distances between the anal and the genital and anal opening. And if it's greater, it's a female. And if it's lesser, it's a male. And how do we distinguish one animal from the other? So we actually look at these signs on the flippers. So on this one, you can see these bite marks. They don't actually heal over time. And that's how we know one individual from the other. So this is the video of a feeding dugong. And during our research in the Andamans, what we found that dugongs are very selective in their diet. So what they actually preferred these really small, tender shoots of seagrasses over the much more fibrous ones. In the earlier images, I showed you these long strands of seagrass. So they don't actually feed on those. They just prefer these really fine ones, if you can see in the video. And the reason for this is that these smaller seagrasses are low in fiber and they're high in nutrients. And hence, they always prefer these seagrasses over the other. And as they're moving, they, like I showed you, they make these distinct serpentine trails. And then after they can stay underwater feeding for about 5 to 7 minutes. And then they need to surface to breathe. And what we also found that while selecting these areas, you know, that they need to feed in, they only chose those areas that were easily accessible. By easily accessible, I mean that, say if an area is, you know, has like a rocky border and it becomes very difficult for a dugong to enter in during a low tide, it will avoid such an area. So the areas need to be easily accessible. Then they need to have these continuous stretches of seagrasses. So this basically has something to do with maximizing the uptake of food. So they spend lesser energy and they get maximum food in that time. So if they have these continuous stretches, they don't actually have to go searching for seagrass within these stretches. And they also select meadows that have another meadow around as well. So it has to be like this, you know, like a group of meadows together. So here you can see after feeding, the dugong is actually surfacing to breathe. With all these initial information that we had, we actually decided to, you know, kind of monitor some of these feeding areas or these feeding grounds of dugongs to actually know how many dugongs were visiting the site of, or, and how much time they spent there or when were they visiting the sites. So we kind of did this with the help of, you know, our local friends or which were actually, who were actually, you know, dive operators or fishermen or people who just lived along the coast. And they helped us monitor some of these sites. And with their results, with what they were seeing and what we actually confirmed by actually going into the water and looking for these feeding signs, we've seen that most of these seagrass meadows that we were monitoring were actually being used by just one or two individuals. And these dugongs were actually feeding there throughout, almost throughout the year and almost throughout the day. And over three or four years that we monitored, we were seeing the same individuals there. So then we thought that, you know, if these animals are being seen in the same place over and over, let's see what's happening to the seagrasses they're feeding on. So now in other parts of the world, where like, once again, I'll give you the example of Australia, because that's where we have most of the information from. So their dugongs move in these large herds and they feed in an area and then they leave an area and then they return back only after several months. But here we are seeing the opposite. So we wanted to see what was happening to the seagrasses. So we looked at, you know, how fast these seagrasses were growing by marking some of these shoots. And we were marking some of these feeding trails with poles like this. So we were actually following dugongs. And once they fed in an area, they created a trail and we marked these trails and monitored these trails to see how long it's taking for the seagrass to come back. So what we found that these seagrasses are growing really fast, like within about, 8 to 10 days, the seagrass recovers completely. And the dugongs were actually only, eating about, or consuming about, say, 30 to 40% of the seagrasses that were actually there in that area or that were actually being produced. So now this is very, what we call it, like a herbivory pressure. This pressure is really low on these seagrasses as compared to in other parts when the numbers are really large. The another thing, what we at the same time what we did is we thought we just look at all the past records of, you know, mortality of dugongs in the area and to see what does that look like. So we looked at all data with various departments or in newspaper articles, and we had like a 60-year data set. And we found that there were almost 70 animals that we had lost, like the Andaman Islands had lost over the last 60 years. And most of it was due to hunting or entanglement in gill nets. Now, gill nets are these nets that the fishermen put with weights at in shallow waters, and when the tide rises, the fish also get trapped there. And because these dugongs need to surface every 5 to 7 minutes, they tend to get entangled in these nets, and they are unable to surface to breathe. So this finding, what this led to is, we found that when we compared dugongs, the areas that dugongs were present about 20, 30 years back, had reduced by almost 50% in the islands, and maybe possibly even the numbers had come down. So what makes these dugongs then so susceptible to extinction? So we may be thinking that, dugongs have such a wide range. They're found all the way from Africa to Australia. And even then, their numbers are so low. And across all these places that they are being found, they are almost close to extinction, except in areas where they are in really large numbers. And this is some of the reasons being they're completely dependent on seagrasses. Sometimes when their habitat is lost, they also don't have food, or they need to move to other areas. They spend most of their time in shallow waters, which make them very susceptible to both strikes or these nets. They're very slow moving. In fact, they the dugongs actually cannot sense, boats are moving really fast. So that's sometimes they also get hit by boat propellers. So if a boat is moving slow, that's when they can sense a boat is in the area, and then they go deeper. Then they have to surface to breathe. And they're also they're long-lived and slow breeders. So they live up to about 70 years, as some of the reports say that. And they give birth to just a single calf once in 5 to 7 years. And this calf actually stays with the mother for almost a year and a half. So with such a slow breeding animal, every time you lose one female, you've actually lost a number of dugongs in that whole population. And a lot of people find the meat really tasty, and hence they are hunted.
Elrika, sorry, very quick question. Are they protected officially in India?
Yes. Oh, I forgot to mention that. So dugongs are protected under the Wildlife Protection Act, and they're given the same protection as a tiger in India. They're protected under Schedule 1, which means that it's completely illegal and it's punishable. It's a punishable offense to kill a dugong. In the Andamans, what we've been seeing is that these continuous threats, like boat collisions, entanglement in gill nets or hunting, have led to such a decline in the population that now you find just these one or two individuals moving around or using certain seagrass meadows, and these you find the same individuals in these particular areas. So while these animals are probably not moving between meadows in search of food, they probably are moving while searching for mates. And this might seem very convenient for a dugong that it does not have to move, but it makes it very susceptible to threats prevailing in that particular seagrass meadow. So some of the things that we've actually been suggesting is that, the only way to actually if you want to save this animal or try and increase its population, is to first let people know about these animals. So we've been trying to create awareness through some of these posters where you tell people, because not many people firstly know dugongs, and they don't know about the kind of animal it is, such as slow breeding or about its life history. So the start is actually by telling people about the animals. And then simple things like them reporting whenever they see an animal, just reporting a sighting, because that actually helps the forest department and researchers to know about where these animals are being found. And then, yes, for sure, we need to stop. People need to consciously think about stopping hunting an animal that's such a slow breeding animal. And then if people avoid using nets in dugong areas, dugong feeding grounds, it would really help getting these animals entangled in fishing nets. And the other thing that is possible to do is that to lower boat speeds when moving around in and around dugong feeding grounds. Because like I said earlier, the animals can actually sense a slow moving boat, and they can move deeper and prevent getting hit by propellers. So with that, I will end here because I'd rather like to take questions from you all instead of me talking. And this is the entire team who's been involved in this research over time, because it's not a one person's work, as you can see. And these are the people who funded us through all this study. Okay, I will stop sharing this and I will start the video here. So the questions will be in the question and Q&A.
Yes. I think Devanshi's got a question. It's already been answered, I think. No, I think it went to answered by mistake. Would you consider the population in Andamans to be philopatric? I don't know who that is. What are their home ranges like? And do they have any natural predators in the Andamans? That's from Devanshi Kasana, who's studying sharks.
Yeah, so it means whether they are, returning or remaining in the same area.
Area.
I don't know whether we can, I don't know whether we can use that term for them at this stage, because we see them moving between a bunch of seagrass meadows. So I'm not sure whether we could say this about them. And in Australia, they do see that some of these dugongs travel about, hundreds of kilometers also in search of food. Whereas I think in Andaman, probably the home ranges are much smaller. Also because the seagrasses are not stretched out as much as in other areas. And in terms of the natural predators, so they do say that, the shark and the saltwater crocodile could be the natural predators of juveniles or of the young one, the calves. But there have been no reports of dugong calves and then being attacked by a shark or a saltwater crocodile. So I hope that has answered your question, Devanshi.
I think somebody else, Lavina, has got a question. What are the other factors that seagrass grows faster here compared to Australia?
What are the other factors?
Why does seagrass grow faster here compared to Australia?
So I won't say just compared to Australia. In fact, a colleague also who's been studying seagrasses in the Arabian Gulf, he says that the seagrasses grow really slow there. So I don't know whether it is to do with the nutrients in the area, or that actually support this kind of growth, or the currents. We're not very sure about why it is why there is a faster growth. But there is, what I forgot to mention is, there is the seasonal growth in the seagrasses. So there are, like, just after the monsoons or during the monsoons, the growth rate slows down a bit, and also during winter, slightly slower growth rate. Whereas in the summer, which is like in the month of March, April, that's when there's a peak growth of seagrasses. So during the monsoon, which I once again forgot to mention, there have been instances where I have also seen, or not only in the monsoons, but sometimes when there are cyclones, where these seagrass meadows with the preferred seagrasses get wiped out. And there are times then that the dugongs will actually shift to eating these non-preferred seagrasses, because that's what's available in the area. So I have seen, these are rare instances, but we have recorded them as well.
Right. Karan has got a question. Do we have an idea of how many individuals exist in the wild?
So in Andamans, we have counted about 23 individuals, but definitely there are areas that we have missed out. But I think they'd probably be less than 50. But I think presently the largest population for India is probably along the Gulf of Mannar, because there are a lot of reports there of sightings and the number of dugongs that actually get trapped in nets. So they have a larger population. But yeah, this is what I know about numbers. So I'm going to read the next question. I hope that, Karan, that answers your question. There's a question by Mrigang. In case of a loss of a calf, does a female go back to estrus like in the cat family? I'm actually not sure about this. I'll have to read about this. I'm not sure about this at all. So another question by Siddharth. They travel hundreds of kilometers in search of new meadows. What do they consume in the absence of sea grasses? So I think that those are in those periods, they are actually not, at least the Australian studies don't show that they are diving in between those, you know, in that transit and are actually feeding. And that there have been some reports where they say sometimes they even eat some amount of algae. So these are the kind of reports, but so either they are not eating or they are eating algae maybe, but these are stray reports as well. How many species we have in India? There's just a single species of dugong in the entire world. What are the other factors that accelerate the growth comparing to Australia? I think this is kind of answered. This is with respect to the seagrasses, I'm assuming. And are they all the questions, or have I missed out some questions?
I think there's one about there's one video. Hang on 1 minute.
Okay, these questions actually come out alphabetically, though.
Yeah, they're being Chandran asks, is there any possibility to get seagrass meadows in the subtidal areas of Gulf of Kutch, as the sedimentation rate is much higher throughout the year?
There are in the Gulf of Kutch. In fact, when I had been there and I was having a discussion with some of the Forest Department staff, they say that they see a lot of seagrass meadows, but they have not told me about the subtidal. They've talked about the intertidal seagrass meadows, because that's what they can see when the tides recede. There will definitely be seagrasses in the subtidal as well, because in Andaman we also see areas that have high sedimentation. But the species that will be there will be the species that, you know, the kind of seagrass present there will be the ones that can actually tolerate this kind of sedimentation if the sedimentation rates are very high.
Okay, is there any data regarding the quantity of seagrass eaten by an individual dugong? How much of its weight does it consume?
So they say that they eat about 30 kgs of seagrass.
And that's every day?
Yeah, they require 30 kilos of approximately 30 kilos. So in fact, when we did some of the, you know, our behavioral work on dugongs, we were following these dugongs, and we found that some of them were actually feeding from like 7 in the morning to 5 or 6 in the evening. And then we had to leave because it turned dark. But the animal just continuously feeds, and they also feed at night in some areas. And then there are times in between where they rest as well, but the feeding is their major activity. So they're just eating most of the time.
Sounds like some of my friends during COVID. Yeah. Amisha Gupta asks, where do dugongs go when they're not feeding? Deeper waters, or do they just hang around?
In some cases, they say that they go into shallow waters. What we've seen is that, in fact, one of the individuals that we were following, it was not feeding. So when it was resting, it just moves like a foot below the surface of water, and it actually shuts its eyes and sleeps. So it's just moving, and every time it has to breathe, just the nostrils will come up and it will breathe. So you can still find them in deeper waters, or they could be going into more sheltered areas.
Has anybody actually done any tracking of dugongs? I know not in India, but perhaps abroad?
Yes, they have. They do put these satellite tags on dugongs, and that's how most of the information is known about movement, because they have these satellite, these tags that they put onto the tail.
Okay. Arusha Pavi asks, can these dugongs be replaced to any kind of captivity or protected space which is not at all disturbed by these hunting activities or all other natural phenomena, like cages for fishes, etc.?
So are you saying that we should try and rear
them
captive? Keep them captive? I don't know whether that's a good idea to have an animal in captivity. because there are lots of factors that actually, you know, govern the life of an animal, its diet. So getting seagrass in natural systems, or we don't know much about the mating, the kind of areas they require for mating, or whether they have preferences with habitats and things like that, and whether we can actually fulfill all of them in captive breeding. In fact, I think sometime in the year 1975, were these three individuals kept in captivity in a small tank somewhere in Tamil Nadu, and they didn't survive. The animal gets stressed, as in dugongs, they see a lot of stress in the animals, even when they are caught for tagging. So I don't think it's a good idea to have these animals in captivity. If we actually wanted to try and increase the population of these animals, we'll have to start by focusing on the habitats and reducing all the threats to the animal. And that's the only way to try and increase the population.
Okay, Sarth is asking, what is the importance of dugongs in their ecosystem? Do they also have multiple stomachs like ruminants?
I think yes, they do. But the role of the dugong, which is something I didn't mention. So by feeding, so we within seagrasses, we have something called the early successional seagrasses and the late succession. So basically, in an area, in an area that's suitable for a seagrass meadow to grow, it'll start off by these really small seagrasses coming up. And over time, it's taken over the smaller seagrasses, which are the ones also preferred by dugongs, which are lepers. And eventually, it's taken over by the more fibrous late successional seagrass species. So what is said is scientists have studied is that by this feeding of dugongs, so by this continuous cropping of these seagrasses, they actually maintain these areas with this preferred seagrass species, and also with the seagrasses with higher nutrients in them. So in areas that were used by dugongs at some point in time, and then now dugongs are absent for some reason, what they found is these seagrass reach to a stage where their nutrient content becomes really low, and then they're not even, preferred by fish or other animals that feed on seagrasses. So dugongs are kind of these gardeners in this system.
Interesting. Gopal Krishnan has got a very technical question. How do dugongs give birth? I knew that would flummox you.
I don't know how do they give birth, because I have...
Has anybody actually ever seen a dugong giving birth?
I don't, not that I know of anyone.
Well, I suppose it should be no different than a dolphin or a...
Yeah, I guess so.
The man.
Yeah. I know a scientist from Australia actually telling me that they go into shallow waters, but I don't know. I don't think they have any... I don't know if any of you have any information or know of any videos or anything, you can are free to put it on this questionnaire Q&A window. But I don't know.
Vardhan, any information on this?
Again, it's difficult to say, as you say there, because we haven't seen it. But what we know from biology is how they give birth based on the data or based on the information that is available. They give what is the interval, but how the whole process is something even we could know.
Nobody's documented.
I don't think so. It's been properly documented.
Okay. All right. Karan has got a question. In the event of habitat disturbance, have dugongs been documenting to shift their grounds? If yes, how far? I think you've mentioned, like in Australia, that they go
about. Yes. Yeah. So I was, in Andaman, in fact, we've noticed this. So, like I said, that there were times where we've been monitoring certain seagrass meadows, and there have been these cyclones that have wiped out some of them. So, in those cases, we did find dugongs moving to nearby meadows. So, I don't know if it's fortunate or unfortunate that at that time, like I said, I mentioned earlier that they use like this network of nearby meadows. So, it's not a single meadow that they'll be feeding on. They always be about 3 or 4 or 5 meadows, say within 1 or 2 kilometer or radius, or even maybe I think 5 kilometers in some case. So within like a 5 kilometer radius, there'll always be several meadows. So we've seen instances actually several times where some of these meadows in this whole network have got completely wiped out during a cyclone, and they have been moving in the other meadows within this whole cluster of meadows. And like I said, in one case where the meadow had completely destroyed, they were also feeding on these other species, the less preferred species as well.
Question is, do they have stranding kind of behavior since they move in herds? Are they also very social?
Do they have what kind of behavior? Stranding.
Stranding, like whales and, you know, stranding on the land.
I don't think if any of that is, I don't think so, because I, the only ones that there was this video which was circulated where there were these two dugongs. They weren't sure, whether it wasn't very clear whether they were mating or they were fighting. But they did come in really shallow water, which was like less than a foot, and the waves were just pushing them back and forth. So that's the only time I thought that there could possibly be a stranding. But no, there have been no reports of them getting stranded. But during like storms and cyclones, we do see, I think in the past, we have seen like, you know, one or two individuals getting washed off dead, but we cannot attribute it to that storm or cyclone. What was the other part of that question? Because I'm unable to see it.
It's moved. Hang on.
Oh, yeah. In the event of hazard.
Yeah. This thing keeps shifting up and down. Yeah.
Yeah. Have dugongs? Oh, the habitat disturbance I answered.
So it was about, are they social?
Yeah.
Are they social? Yes. Yes. Yeah. They are social. They are social. They move in herds. Yes, they are. But the thing is, in Andamans, This social, you know, this social aspect, what they have been seeing in these large herds, we've seen an animal individuals moving in pairs, but that's all that we've seen. We've not seen a larger herd to talk a lot about the social behavior. But yes, dugongs are social animals. In fact, during mating, they also form these leks where you have these females and lots of males around. So they are very social animals as well.
So the Andamans variety does not get together for conferences, etc. Right?
I don't know if they did that in the past, but
yeah, sad. Okay, Siddharth is back again. Why does the nutrient value of seagrass decrease as they grow? Also, how is the seagrass different from terrestrial grass? How does grass survive in salty water?
Oh, there are so many questions in that.
Yes.
I think the first
nutrient
one
value, why does it decrease?
So when I talked about nutrient value decreasing, what I meant was that, so even in terrestrial systems where, you know, people have studied the effect of, say, these herbivores on land and on their effect on grasses, what they see is that when this cropping happens, when an animal crops these the tops of the leaves, the whole mechanism of the plant causes it to increase its nutrient content. And that's where I spoke about when there is this continuous cropping, the nutrient content in the plant gets higher. Whereas if it's allowed to reach this, you know, this die off or this old stage, the nutrient content lowers in plants. So it's more in as a, not exactly a, I don't know whether you call it a defense mechanism where the nutrient content's in, but it's one of the mechanisms to handle herbivory. And what was next in that?
How is seagrass different from terrestrial grass?
They're completely different. In fact, they're not even in the same family. So seagrasses have actually evolved from terrestrial plants, but they are not in the same family as the Poaceae, which the terrestrial grasses are from. But they, so that's all I can tell you about. But they do have these rhizomes. In fact, they have these flowers also, which we see underwater, lovely flowers of seagrasses. So there are several families in seagrasses. Some of them are closely related to the lilies. Some of them are, related to some of the water, freshwater plants. So you can't just group them. They are commonly called seagrasses, yes, but they, even within seagrasses, they are all not related to each other. They might be related to something more closely on land.
And his last part of the question is, how does grass survive in salt water, salty water?
Oh, that's you'll have to. I think it's obviously it has got to do with the physiology. But I'm not very clear on the details of that. But
I guess that's just evolution, right?
Yeah, it's evolution.
Millions of years. Yeah. Okay, Devanshi's got a question. Did you notice a decline in dugong mortality from gill nets and collisions with increasing community awareness or decline in consumption?
So in some of the islands that we've worked in, say for example in areas where we've been working with the community there, they have definitely been more engaged in trying to protect the few animals that are found around their areas, around their island. And with respect to hunting, I don't think we've forced people to try and stop hunting. We've kind of given them the information that they need to know about the animal and given them the choice. So lots of the communities that we work with in the Nicobar Islands, they have you know, constantly been having discussions about how it's probably not a nice thing right now, given, you know, kind of animal this is, such a slow breeding animal, to actually kill another animal. So whether they have made that choice, I'm not sure. But the other thing is the numbers also are so low that now they don't find dugongs to even hunt that easily. So whether the mortality has decreased over the years, they have been, like say since 2005, they have been, I think, a few cases of mortality. Some of them not due to hunting or to to gill nets, but just, I don't know, maybe disease or old age. It is low, but I don't know what was the rate, the mortality rate earlier, whether it was much higher. Hunting definitely was much higher, but right now the numbers also are so low, and that's why we're not seeing that many dugongs being hunted. So it's a two-way thing. So I'm not going to say that it has decreased, but we have had less reports. How do they react to humans?
Mm-hmm. What was your interactions? Yeah.
So dugongs are very shy. In fact, I think these only two individuals that we managed to get videos of were the only two individuals. Well, there's one more individual whom I know of who is least bothered about animals, about humans around them. But all the other animals that we've seen, the moment they know that there's a boat around, also they swim really far. So they are very shy animals. I think also these three individuals that we were able to film were also used to people, because there were people swimming constantly in that area. Lots of tourists, basically in tourist areas where people were snorkeling around. So they kind of were used to animals. But then you do have to keep your safe distance, because the moment you try and get close, they will swim away.
Okay, so I have heard rumors from divers that sometimes they get amorous and they pin you to the floor. So my question is, number one, have you ever had that experience? And number two, did you file sexual harassment charges?
I don't think that. I've not experienced any of that.
I think I should ask this question to Vardhan also. Yeah. Would you say that behavior? Luckily, okay. Would you say there are any similarities in behavior in terms of how they react, etc., as compared to manatees? Is there a similarity? Because from what I know, manatees are only freshwater, right? They're in the Florida Everglades, etc.
They are. They also go into some of the estuarine waters.
Okay.
And but mostly fresh water. But yeah, in Florida they are in the estuarine waters as well. Princess, their behaviors are quite similar, actually. In behavior, in terms of what, is there any specific
I mean, in terms of, like, for example, migration or feeding patterns, what they feed on?
Oh, the manatees definitely have a different diet because there'll be a lot of these freshwater vegetation that they'll be feeding on. So in terms of diet, definitely, in terms of how they react to like boats and all, it's quite similar. And in fact, I've seen these where I've seen them mostly, like the images that I've seen also are of lots of them in these really shallow waters herding together. So very similar behaviors, but diet obviously is different. Also their movement could be different because they're moving in different systems.
Right.
I think this question is not being answered, which is, can seagrass be artificially planted or grown in the sea in order to increase feeding grounds? Alrika?
Yeah, so there are cases where they do seagrass transplantation in areas that have lost seagrass. So in Andaman, at least, the problem is not of lesser feeding grounds. The problem is that there are not many dugongs to eat up that seagrass. So unless we actually hit that problem where there's not enough seagrass to support the dugongs, then we can probably consider this transplantation or this what we call grass restoration. In fact, in Lakshadweep, that's something that we are considering over there. The turtle being the one feeding and actually wiping out these seagrass meadows. And we've had areas where seagrasses are completely wiped out. So in those areas, we are actually considering this transplantation or this restoration of seagrass meadows by removing it from places where there were seagrasses earlier. There are seagrasses and then putting it back in areas where there were seagrasses in the past. But it takes a lot of effort, yes, and the success rates are quite low, but this is something we will be trying in that system. But there's no need to try that.
What if the reports about WTI getting involved in saving the dugong off the coast of Tamil Nadu? Are they very active in it?
WTI or the Wildlife Institute of India?
Probably Wildlife Institute of India. Sorry, I got too confused here.
Yes, I think they are involved. In fact, they're working, I think, with the forest department, so the government level to study the dugongs and also involved in a lot of awareness and education in fact, all the three areas in Andamans, in the Gulf of Mannar, so in Tamil Nadu and in along the Gujarat coast.
What is your realistic view of the future of the dugongs? I mean, I'm not talking about very large scale stepping up of conservation efforts, but given the status that exists today, what is the outlook?
So there are hopes, as in there are, I thought that the dugongs of the Andamans were on their way out. In fact, that can happen at any time considering the populations are so low. But we do see a lot of mother calf pairs. In fact, in the last, I think, 4 or 5 years, we've seen three mother calf pairs have been reported. And that's a good sign for such a small number of dugongs that we know of. And I think the only hope for this animal actually lies with the people who share these spaces, because it's up to them. And it's only them who can actually help save the animal and its habitat. And they'll probably have to stand up against all these development activities that are happening in and around dugong habitat. So it's bleak for this population because it's very slow breeding. But there are hopes. But it has to be a constant effort. Otherwise, it will be less than 10 years where probably the dugong in the Andamans can probably get wiped out because the numbers are so low. But on the other hand, we also do not have information about movement of dugongs between, say, the northernmost islands in Andaman and the Bangladesh from that border there, or the Indonesian side and the Nicobar, whether they are actually making those movements. So The future of this animal is bleak, but there are hopes.
That's good to know. Karan has come with a question. With respect to marine animals, where does the dugong stand on the evolutionary chart?
Oh, that's a very... Maybe I can answer this question directly to you, Karan. If you can write to me, I can send you this whole evolutionary chart of the dugong.
All right. If you can put your email address on the chat window, please, then we can send your email.
Yes.
Preston has got a question. Are their habitats protected? And has there been any study done with microchipping or such similar tracking? I think you answered that.
The habitats are, some of the habitats that fall within national parks are protected, marine parks are protected.
Okay. If not, then would that be helpful or harmful in understanding their ecology? He's talking about tracking or microchipping.
So tracking will give you a lot of information about movement, but there are lots of other things that you need to know about dugongs as well. So about like just about their habitats, how they're recovering, how they're faring. It's not only about understanding the dugong, but also understanding the habitats and the changes that are happening there. So I'm putting my email ID over here in the chat.
Yeah.
And you can write to me there.
Okay.
Then there is this question by Siddha. You mentioned that they travel hundreds of kilometers in search of new meadows. What do they consume in the absence of seagrass?
I think that was answered.
Oh yeah, I answered that one.
Yeah. Freston has got one more question. Has global warming affected their ecologies? And if yes, then are we doing anything to protect them in captivity?
So global warming is definitely affecting their habitat because their habitats are declining and lots of the seagrass meadows are being lost in certain areas. So that is what I know of the, you know, the dugongs being affected or how the dugongs are being affected by global warming.
Right, I think we've come to the end of it. Yeah, I don't think there are any more questions. Come on guys, anything else? Post it fast. I can see a similarity between the elephant and the dugong in your photographs. At least the face part of it, very remotely. It looks like a premature elephant with its trunk chopped off, right? To put it bluntly. But yeah.
Yeah, in fact, they do have tusks as well, mainly.
Oh yeah, that's very interesting, you know, yeah. Now, is there anybody else studying dugongs that you know of, Elrica?
There are lots of students working with the Wildlife Institute of India who are studying.
Only in the Gulf of Mannar or also Andamans?
In Andamans too, in the Gulf of Mannar and in the Gulf of Kutch. So I don't know what their research focus is, but they are on the larger project for dugongs and seagrasses. So.
I was a bit taken aback to read somewhere that, I mean, the report was old. It was about 5 or 6 years old, and they reported something like 200 to 250 dugongs off the coast of Tamil Nadu.
That's possible, actually, to really? Have that. No. Because I remember also reading some reports or some articles in the past where they have reported that many dugongs. So like I said, Tamil Nadu coast is probably one of the places in India that has the largest population for India. But I don't know what the population is like right now.
All right. I think that's about it. Unless anybody else got any questions, that's one. What's their pod size? Well, I guess that varies from place to place, as Elrica said.
by their herd size.
Yeah.
I think there are reports of 300 to 400 dugongs also in a herd, but not in India, like in Australia. Then a colleague of mine who from Abu Dhabi, I think he told me that in his last survey that he did some months back, that was before March, he actually seen about 250 animals. He counted 250 animals in a herd.
Wow. Are they the same species as the ones in India?
Yes, this is one species.
It's only one species, right? Sorry. Yeah. Okay, I think we're going to wrap it up. Elrica, thank you very, very much.
You're most welcome. Us. Any of you have questions, do write to me and I can answer them then.
Yes, and also Vardhan, thanks a lot for taking the time out. I know you guys are seriously busy, so it's cutting into your family time, etc. And thank you so much. And thank you, SSI, for providing the platform as always. And of course, thanks to the audience who've been really good. They've been really quiet, but they have asked questions. It's wonderful. Thank you. See you guys for the next one. We will be posting all the details soon. Bye-bye. Good night, guys. Thank you.
Good night.